Buenos días. Buenos días. Soy José Luis Suárez, profesor del IESE y también director de este campus, del campus de Madrid. Bueno, a pesar de que estábamos todos preparados un minuto antes, esperé justo a la hora porque tenemos 400 personas inscritas en remoto. O sea que empezamos puntuales como siempre. Bueno, esta es la décima edición de Energy Prospectives, que como saben es una iniciativa conjunta de la Fundación Naturgy y del IESE. Está a mi lado Rafael Villaseca, que es presidente de la Fundación Naturgy, y aprovecho para una vez más darle las gracias por la confianza depositada en el IESE a la hora de organizar conjuntamente esta serie de reuniones de primer nivel. El primer encuentro de Energy Prospectives tuvo lugar en marzo de 2019. En aquella época todos éramos conscientes de que la energía y su transición era un tema ambiental, social y económico de primera magnitud, y por eso se puso en marcha esta serie. Pero no imaginábamos que habría nuevos acontecimientos que reforzarían esa importancia. En 2020 llegó el COVID. Como se suele decir, las crisis no generan tendencias, pero acentúan las que están en curso. Una de esas era la sostenibilidad. Se acentuaron significativamente las exigencias en esta materia y se plasmaron códigos concretos. Se popularizó el ESG, Environment, Social and Governance, el ESG, y se perfiló la taxonomía de la Unión Europea. Y ahora, en este año, Rusia, primordial proveedor de petróleo y gas de Europa, invade Ucrania. Y en estos días, ayer y hoy, estamos viviendo una inestabilidad financiera que, entre otras cosas, provocó una reunión inesperada del Banco Central Europeo de ayer. Todos estos factores tienen su impacto en la transición energética y, al revés, la energía afectó a esas fuerzas que intentaron modularla. Es el caso del concepto de ESG. A pesar de ser omnipresente en los últimos tiempos, puede sucumbir a los avatares de la energía, ya que hay situaciones que hoy en día enfrentan a una letra con otra. Por ejemplo, cuando se va contra la E de Environment para reducir la dependencia del gas de Rusia por razones éticas. Recuerdo que en 2019, al principio de esta serie, imaginábamos cuándo llegaría el impacto de la transición energética al ciudadano. ¿Y cuál sería su reacción al conocer las implicaciones de la misma en su bienestar? Ahora ya lo tenemos delante. Ese impacto ha llegado en el enorme incremento de precios de la energía y los combustibles y una incertidumbre en el suministro, sobre todo de cara al invierno que viene. Es necesario atender a la inquietud de la sociedad por muchos motivos. Primero, por el impacto de la situación en las personas, sobre todo de los más necesitados, pero también por la tranquilidad social que necesitamos para avanzar de manera reflexiva. Nadie tiene la sensación de que está trazado el camino para culminar la transición. Hasta las normativas a todos los niveles todavía tienen que demostrar su eficacia y también, dado su carácter intervencionista, son necesariamente temporales y deberán suprimirse o modificarse. Esta introducción no tiene la intención de dar una nota pesimista, sino todo lo contrario. La humanidad ha salido de situaciones muy difíciles y lo hará también en este caso, pero sí me sirve para afirmar la vigencia del foro que constituye Energy Prospectives y su necesidad. Estoy seguro de su aportación positiva al debate, no solo por los magníficos ponentes que hemos tenido, sino también por las más de 3.000 personas que nos han acompañado. Finalizo reiterando la bienvenida a todos los asistentes, presentes y remoto, including a warm welcome to our guest speakers this morning that will be properly introduced by my colleague Xavier Vives, the moderator. También reiteraré mi agradecimiento a la Fundación Naturgy. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, José Luis. Sin hacer excesivo mi agradecimiento al IESE por brindarnos el apoyo en la realización de estas jornadas, esta actual y las que han precedido, y la satisfacción por ya estar en la décima con un cierto eco positivo por parte de todas las personas que nos han atendido. Quisiera especialmente agradecer a quienes presencialmente nos están ahí acompañando aquí y sobre todo a las muchas personas que están conectadas para atender esta reunión online. Singularmente también nos va a
sin la conexión no se me oye bien. Resumo, quería agradecer la asistencia de todas las personas presencialmente y a las muchas que se han conectado, auténtico récord de conexión online, y quería agradecer singularmente a nuestro moderador, el profesor Xavier Vives, que lo va a hacer online por razones de COVID, pero que ha tenido la gentileza de atendernos y moderarla en la distancia, pero seguro con el acierto que siempre ha tenido. Muchas gracias a todos y recordar, algunos ya lo conocen, cuál es el foco de nuestra fundación en estas materias. La verdad es que nuestra fundación más o menos puede resumirse, simplificadamente, en que la mitad la dedicamos de nuestras actividades y recursos a cuestiones sociales, pobreza energética, vulnerabilidad, rehabilitación energética de hogares, formación, educación, actividad de la que estamos muy satisfechos y orgullosos y que también está teniendo un cierto eco en la sociedad que intentaremos incrementar en un futuro inmediato. Y en segundo lugar, la elaboración de una serie de estudios, trabajos, seminarios, papers, libros incluso, relacionados con el tema de la energía y que patrocinamos, divulgamos y proponemos a la sociedad como elementos de reflexión para sobre todo intentar establecer cuáles son los datos en los que se asienta la problemática energética y cuáles son las perspectivas que hay. En repetidas ocasiones, me lo habrán escuchado, lamento repetirme, pero creemos que la necesidad de establecer datos fiables sobre los que basar la toma de decisiones, especialmente las públicas, es una necesidad creciente y modestamente hemos querido colaborar mediante esas publicaciones y esos debates para conseguir el que estén accesibles a aquellas personas que han de tomar decisiones relativas a este importantísimo sector. Y ahí nos centra estas jornadas que llevamos a cabo con el IESE, que tienen por objeto sobre todo la perspectiva, cuál es la situación y la perspectiva del sector energético. Lo decía José Luis, de que desde hace muchos años la transición energética ha dominado el escenario de la toma de decisiones y de las políticas públicas y privadas en relación a este sector. Eso es así. Sin embargo, no hay ninguna duda tampoco que la crisis especialmente europea derivada de la guerra en Ucrania ha acelerado todas las tensiones que veníamos padeciendo y le ha añadido una enorme vulnerabilidad. Sin embargo, y esperando y confiando en una próxima resolución del problema, no cabe duda que existen tendencias de fondo, muchas de ellas derivadas de la transición energética, cuestión necesaria y obligada que debemos abordar, pero esas cuestiones nos llevarán a que los procesos que están en el fondo sigan ocupándonos y necesitando de importantes decisiones. Por esa razón, hemos pensado siempre que debíamos prestar una singular atención a todo lo que significa la transición energética. Y en esta ocasión concreta hemos querido poderles presentar a dos ponentes que nos ilustren sobre cómo se está llevando a cabo la transición energética en dos lugares muy significativos y además qué perspectivas tienen respecto a qué es lo que puede suceder en un horizonte a un plazo más o menos razonable. Va a ser muy interesante poder constatar cómo se está llevando a cabo esta transición energética en los Estados Unidos y en concreto en uno de sus estados más importantes, California, y cómo se ve cómo está evolucionando la transición energética en Europa, abanderado de todo el proceso de descarbonización de la energía, con unas tensiones además actualmente incrementadas notablemente por la crisis de Ucrania. Para eso hemos tenido la suerte de contar, tenemos la suerte de contar con dos ponentes de gran nivel a quienes agradezco la amabilidad por acompañarnos hoy en estas jornadas. Está con nosotros Klaus-Dieter Borchardt. Klaus-Dieter Borchardt ha sido un muy alto representante de la Unión Europea, exdirector general adjunto de Energía de la Comisión. Y además ha continuado sus actividades relacionadas con el mundo de la energía en el bufete Baker & McKenzie y ligado también al Instituto de Estudios Energéticos de Oxford. Sin duda, amplio conocedor de esta problemática, nos podrá ilustrar claramente desde el punto de vista europeo cómo ve esta situación. Y para tener la perspectiva de otro gran polo de atención y de importancia en lo que significa el mundo energético en el mundo, tenemos a Hannon Rasool. Hannon Rasool es director general adjunto de la California Energy Commission. Nos va a dar el punto de vista de un país que afronta, también con interés y decisión, pero de una manera distinta, sin duda, cómo es la transición energética a una sociedad que tenga que hacer frente a los riesgos del cambio climático. Queremos con ello colaborar, modestamente nosotros, ellos sin duda con gran acierto y profundidad, a establecer datos, opiniones solventes sobre qué es lo que sucede. Insisto, y con ello acabo, en demasiadas ocasiones soluciones simplistas, aparentemente fáciles y además siempre con un barniz que solo observa las caras positivas de las cuestiones, ocupan los titulares y ocupan las decisiones. Creemos que es importante que para ser eficaces en ese objetivo, que sin duda alguna todos tenemos, y es promover a la sociedad de energía sostenible, de una energía fiable y de una energía económicamente también a unos niveles razonables, se tengan que partir de bases, datos y argumentos sólidos. Insisto, queremos colaborar a ello y por eso estas jornadas de hoy se van a centrar con esos dos ponentes en esta cuestión tan relevante. Y nada más, concluyo aquí, esperando que la jornada les interese a todos ustedes y agradeciéndoles de nuevo su interés para con nosotros y estas jornadas. Muchas gracias. Gentlemen, the floor is yours.
Good morning. I'm going to moderate virtually these sessions on the visions of the energy transition, California and Europe, of the 10th edition of this Energy Perspective Industry meeting. Let me just thank you, José Luis and Rafael, for the introduction and also for introducing the speakers. Let me start by saying that, as I say here in the slides, it is said that things happen first in California, then in the US, and then Europe and the rest of the world. And I think there is some truth to it. And so I think particularly insightful today to have here someone that will speak what's going on and how the energy transition is being thought in California and then in Europe. I think we can learn we can learn a few lessons. Before giving the floor to our distinguished speakers, I would like to present very briefly some data on energy prices, because at the end of the day, it's true the energy transition worries us a lot, but today the pressure of high energy prices, in particular in Europe, but not only, is indeed extreme. So why are energy, and in particular electricity prices, so high? Before Russia's war and an aggression in Ukraine, already prices were going up. So if we look at the energy electricity prices at the wholesale market level in Spain, we see they were relatively flat until 2021, where they climbed, okay? And so reaching a peak in December 2021. And this is not only in Spain. So if we do the same exercise for Europe, this is very similar across all European electricity markets, obviously with some variations. The Nord Pool, the prices are lower for known reasons, but we see also a peak in December 2021. Why are those prices so high? Well, obviously we have demand factors, the post-pandemic recovery, high demand in Asia, weather shocks, winters perhaps colder than usual or summers hotter than usual. But then we have supply constraints, which are very important. The high increase in natural prices, the increase in the CO2 prices, sometimes also disruptions due to lower wind availability, plant failures, grid bottlenecks, as we know, and also, and importantly, the market power of producers. We see how Gazprom has used its power to raise prices of gas. It is doing it now. But not only now, it seems that Gazprom did it, in fact, in preparation of the war on Ukraine by restricting supply in the spot market. but also, and this is more related directly to the topic today, there are capacity restrictions that perhaps capacity in fossil fuels was subdued due to the perspective of the green transition. And so we'll see what our panelists think about that. And also because the shift from fossil fuels to renewables is relatively slow still. It has a long way to go. What about after February 28, when the war started? Then geopolitical risk is king. We see that the increase in prices up to December 21, then it was relaxed, but during the crisis, it went up again. And not only, obviously, these are the European, the prices, the electricity prices in the European spot markets, but also if we see the gas prices, there is an upward trend from the beginning of 2021 with several peaks. The red line is the beginning of the conflict. We see huge peaks and then a lot of volatility, as you see, but with at a level of high prices. Similarly, for oil, no, oil prices have jumped above 120 euros, and we see how also at the beginning of the conflict, it keeps going up, but also there is extreme volatility in the price. What are the implications for the green transition? Well, this is something to discuss. Obviously, there are many, many questions. We know that climate change is global. In particular, if China does not get on board, our efforts will not be very useful. We may think whether the high energy prices are a result of the energy transition or not, or what are going to be the implications. Are these high energy prices going to speed up or slow down the energy transition? Will Ukraine's war accelerate the move towards green technologies or not? Do we have to change the rules of the wholesale market? There is a vivid debate in Spain. You are aware of the Iberian exception in the wholesale market. What do we have to do? What is the best electricity market design for the energy transition? How it would look like in 2050, this wholesale market? Will we have still fossil backup facilities in this market or not? What is the best strategy for Europe? I think all these really will, and more, will be dealt today here. And finally, before I give the floor to the to our speakers, let me mention and show this triangle that everyone wants. In energy. That's to say, to have cheap energy, green energy, and secure and stable. Can we have it all? In the short run, it's obvious that we cannot. Now, we are seeing problems, I would say, everywhere, no, in all the angles, in all the vertex of this triangle. So how it will evolve, how will the tensions in this triangle evolve? How are we going to resolve the trade-offs in the objectives between having cheap energy, green energy, and secure and stable energy? Nothing else. These are my initial remarks, and I will give the floor now first to Klaus Dieter, who will speak, and then we'll go to the second speaker and we'll open a debate. So thank you very much for being here. I know that both of you, you are experts in the green transition and energy experts. And as I said, I think that to put together the lessons from California and Europe, it's a very, not only a very good idea, but I think that it will have, we will learn a lot from that. And I give the floor to Klaus Dieter.
Thank you very much, Xavier. And good morning, everyone here. At this nice location, and also those who are following us online. It's a great pleasure, and thank you very much to the Naturgy Foundation and also to the ECU Business School for having invited me to this interesting discussion here this morning. Energy perspectives. My job is to do that from the European perspective, and Hannon will do that from the Californian perspective, and I think that's a very nice combination, and I think we can mutually learn from each other, so I hope at least. Energy perspectives from the European point of view, Xavier has already pointed to the big challenges that we are currently facing, and it is absolutely not possible for me to go into all the possible areas, but I have made a selection. And first, I would like to give you a bit the background. Why do we have these challenges, and where are they, and what does it mean for the energy transformation? I will then go through certain areas. I thought it's always important, although certain in Europe doesn't like to talk about natural gas, I do, and I also feel that it is necessary. We will have a look into the hydrogen scenery, renewable energy, wind, solar, and also biomethane, and then energy efficiency very briefly, and also the financing of the RePowerEU. And then last but not least, also what Xavier mentioned, the energy prices and the market design. It's a huge program, as you can see, and I hope that I can do that all in the time that was allocated to me. So let's start with the background. As you all know, in the Versailles EU summit, where the heads of state and government in March this year have decided to end the dependency of imports from Russia, natural gas from Russia, and replacing it by other means, Russian gas and oil. But even before Russia invaded Ukraine, as Xavier mentioned, gas prices went up and went even through the roof because of the high demand after the COVID pandemic, that the prices went out of the control. But then also, you have seen that on the slide that Xavier showed, when the war started on the 24th of February, the prices again spiked. So what we see as a result of it is that almost everybody is suffering. The citizens and businesses are facing historically high energy prices. The production and jobs in the energy intensive industries are endangered. And also we have very, very high and still increasing inflation rate. And with that all together, we have an acceleration of energy poverty. So now these are the challenges that we have to deal with and to cope with in our energy system. So what does that mean now for the energy transformation that we have already started in Europe? We call it the European Green Deal. So a net zero carbon economy by 2050 with intermediate targets in 2030. What does it mean now when we are facing these challenges? For me, the most important statement that also the Commission, European Commission has made is, we should not lose sight of these climate targets that we have. We have to continue to lay the foundation for the decarbonization. We should not use these new challenges as an argument to slow down or even to deviate from the general path of decarbonization. The climate challenge is still our biggest challenge globally. And therefore, it is important that we keep the pace, and we are trying to use all what we can do within the decarbonization and the transformation of the energy system in order to cope with the challenges. So that means is something like squaring this, the circle, and it is extremely difficult. And there is no silver bullet, let's be clear. And as Xavier has said, what we have to try to achieve is that we are bringing together this triangle of objectives: sustainability, security of supply, and competitiveness, or call it affordability. These are the three elements. And what we have seen in the past in Europe is that these objectives, which should be pursued together, have been pursued individually. Give you the examples. The Fit for 55 package that the Commission has proposed last summer was purely 100% based on sustainability. There was nothing of affordability or security of supply. Then came the first price peak. All of a sudden, affordability came back into the picture, and the Commission made a communication and invited member states to take the right measures in order to alleviate, especially for the vulnerable customers, the situation. And then came the war in Ukraine, and all of a sudden, security of supply was there, and this has already changed certain mindsets in Brussels. Not enough, but still, security of supply is back on the agenda. And it's rightly so. Xavier is right. It's terribly difficult to pursue all the three at the same time, at the same degree. But we have to, when we are taking measures, when we are developing policies, we have to make an assessment what it means for each of these three objectives. So that is a bit the introduction, the background. For me, in this sense, what the Commission has done with the Repower EU package, in which I will now enter, is the right thing. So I underline that because I have not so much in common with the Repower EU package, but this is the right thing that the Commission has put it on the table. But let us have a look a bit into the details how this Repower EU package looks. And I will only concentrate, I think there are 13 documents that the Commission has published, staff working documents, etc. I will concentrate on these four documents: the Repower EU plan, the most important one. Then you have a communication on EU safe energy, that's energy efficiency, communication of a new solar strategy, and then also the communication of the EU external energy engagement. So this we will now have a look, what does it mean now for the different sector. And here you have first for natural gas. Here for natural gas, the challenge of course is how can we get out of the dependency of Russian gas. And here the Commission proposes three pillars of measures. The first is diversification. We should decouple from Russian natural gas imports, and that means looking for other suppliers, other resources of gas, not only natural gas, especially LNG is an option, and of course we will see also hydrogen. The second is we have to accelerate the deployment of renewable energy, especially solar and wind. And the third is also we have to look what it means for the high prices and how the high prices play into this transformation. Now, this is an interesting slide, as you can see. The heads of state and government have said we want to go out of Russian gas. When we look at the figures, you have current EU gas demand, 400 BCM, roughly. Then, if you look what the Commission has proposed under the Fit for 55, and the Commission suggested or projected that under the Fit for 55, one could reduce the demand of natural gas by 30%, so 116 BCM. Then we have the higher long-term gas and oil prices. We expect that the high level of gas and oil prices will stay at least until 2025, maybe even a bit longer. And that will also have an impact on the gas demand. The projection is that it will be about 40 BCM until 2030. That will be reduced. And then you have the implementation of the measures that are under the Repower EU, which is additional 100 BCM, exactly 94. If you do the addition of these figures, you get to an overall reduction in 2030 by 250 BCM. But we have imported last year from Russia only 155. So it's almost 100 BCM of natural gas reduction more than is needed to cover the Russian imports. What does that mean? For me, it means what the Commission is doing here, it's a disguised phasing down or even phasing out natural gas until 2030. And let me be clear, that's a mistake. So what do we have as measures in order to go through the pillars? The first is the import diversification. And here the Commission and the Member State have already set up what they call an EU energy platform for a common voluntary purchase of gas, LNG and hydrogen. What this platform, it's already in motion, is doing, it's demand aggregation and structuring. It is optimizing the infrastructure that is needed and also the international outreach. So especially the Commission, who is doing energy dialogues with more than 100 countries in the world, that you can use this also to open doors for businesses to enter also in connection with other businesses in those countries. This is a good tool. But now the Commission does not stop there. The Commission says, we will set up a dedicated work stream on joint purchasing for hydrogen first, and then is considering to open that also for LNG and natural gas. And that's a bad idea. Because this kind of voluntary joint purchasing platform does not make sense. Because, let me remain with natural gas. Those who are in the gas business, they know how complex these gas contracts are, how long-term contracts are concluded, that traditional relationship, business relationships exist that are more promising to get good conditions out of it than the so-called purchasing power that an aggregation and a common purchase platform would deliver. And what the Commission is looking at is nothing else than a buyer's cartel. And I personally have my huge doubts that this can go down so easily with the European competition law. They need an exemption for that, and that gives a very bad example also for the cases that you might have in the private business. So therefore, I think this tool should not be introduced. Investment in infrastructure. The Commission considers that investments in infrastructure in the magnitude of 10 billion euros will be required by 2030. And this infrastructure goes into LNG import terminals, reinforcement of existing pipelines, etc. The Commission has also indicated some concrete projects that will be developed, especially on the LNG side. And then regarding LNG, the Commission wants to give public support to the LNG infrastructure. And also, and here it's interesting, then the Commission says, we are giving public money for the LNG infrastructure provided it's hydrogen ready. And I have not found anybody so far who could tell me, what does it mean, hydrogen ready? What does it require? If I have today an LNG terminal, what concrete measures do I have to take and how much does it cost to convert it into an hydrogen terminal? All the experts I have spoken to say that's nonsense. We have to build a new one. It's not just that I fiddle around with what I have, it's completely different. So therefore, this is wishful thinking. It is just to say that, normally we don't like natural gas, even LNG, but we need LNG and therefore we want to promote it, but it has to be hydrogen ready, and that is then the sustainability that is given. But that is pure, theory, has nothing to do with the reality. Then what we found out when you go through the papers, only in the international side, carbon capture and storage is mentioned. It's very, very surprising, because you can look into all the reports from the International Energy Agency and others, where it is stated that for a cost-effective and fast accelerated transformation, carbon capture and storage and usage is indispensable. And I believe that. Nothing, not a word in these papers that I'm looking at now are done. Hydrogen, I have to speed up. You see, current situation, we have a global hydrogen market, it's a global commodity market, and we also know that electricity-only decarbonization isn't practical. So, yes, hydrogen can be something to look at. New targets in the Repower EU. 10 million tons domestic renewable hydrogen production by 2030 and 10 million tons of renewable hydrogen imports by 2030. That means, compared to what the Commission has proposed last year, it's simply doubling again the figures. And I can tell you already, I already didn't believe in the figures they have put forward last year. So let us have a look at it. So it's 6 million tons of renewable hydrogen and 4 million tons of mostly ammonia or other derivatives. And here you see already the import corridors. North Sea, mostly United Kingdom. Mediterranean, only Egypt is mentioned. And then Ukraine, when the conditions are there. You have in the external dimension communication also mentioning the Gulf region and North Africa. North Africa is interesting as a corridor, because how do you bring from North Africa the hydrogen to Europe? There are two possible ways, via Spain or via Italy. And now you compare which route will make it. It will not be the Spanish one. Why? Because it was until now not possible to solve the bottleneck between Spain and France. The projects MidCat and STEP are still frozen. And it's a scandal, because it was agreed at the highest political level with the facilitation of the Commission that these projects have to go forward. And not only for the hydrogen, but also for the LNG. You have the capacities, free capacities of LNG in the terminals here, and you cannot bring it there where it is needed, because you have this bottleneck between Spain and France. This has to be urgently to be changed. Then you have the hydrogen investment that you can see there. I will not go into detail, so I will speed up. Now, this is also an interesting slide, because domestic consumption, you can see, I said already, 16 million of hydrogen and 4 million in form of ammonia. The only interesting point is here, 1.3, I think, million ton for blending. And that is interesting, because in all other papers, the Commission has said blending at the transmission level is not an option for us. Now, all of a sudden, they come and say, 1.3 million tons we can blend into. I also do not follow this, because if you do this blending, you need to have also the technology for de-blend, because hydrogen is a high-value product, and if you blend it with natural gas, you are destroying this value. So you have to take it out again. But that's only one comment. More interestingly is the domestic production, 10 million tons. What does that mean? That means, first and foremost, most of the additional renewable sources, wind and solar energy, has to go into electrolyzers in order to produce this hydrogen. That means there is not additional green electricity to continue the electrification where it is still possible. And there are fields where it is still possible. And that doesn't make sense, because the cheapest, the most cost-effective way to handle this is to use the green electricity for electrification and not to produce hydrogen. So that is the first criticism. The second is, there is a big project in Saudi Arabia. It's the new one. And they have calculated that for producing per year 0.23 million tons of hydrogen, they need 4 gigawatts of wind or solar power. So now we want to produce domestically 10 million tons. You know what it means? Irrealistic, completely irrealistic. Renewable energy, wind, solar, hydrogen, biomethane. I go fast now. Here you have the all renewable energy. The Repower EU increases again the overall renewable energy target from 40% fit for 55 to 45%. What does that mean? By 2030, we have to reach 69% of renewable energy in our mix, 37 today. We did in 2019 3%. Okay, if you now take that this is possible every year, you might get there, but it's a big question mark, big question mark. Then by 2030, the share of wind and solar capacity have to increase from 33% to 67%, and renewable in heatings and cooling would increase to 46%. Also with wishful thinking, in my view. And then transport is lowest 10% today, has to reach 32% by 2030. Good luck. Then you have, of course, and this is also something positive, should not be only negative, some legislative amendments to speed up and to facilitate permitting of renewable projects. That, I think, is a good move, because a lot of projects have suffered from the long permitting periods. And this is now really something, mapping the areas, obliging member states to map the areas, renewable go-to areas have to be identified. These things will happen. And if you are in such an area, you do not have to have the environmental impact assessment and these kind of things, because that has to be done when the area is determined. So that could be a very good move in order to foster the deployment of renewables. Now, very briefly, the solar energy, again, the targets, 320 gigawatts of solar newly installed by 2025. This means that's twice the level of today, and means that you have to put in a country like Luxembourg, whole Luxembourg, under PV panels. And by 2030, 600 gigawatt, twice the Luxembourg. Where do we get these areas? So you can see, one important thing on the solar is, and that as an idea, is a good idea to use the rooftop for solar. And there is an initiative, European Solar Rooftop Initiative, where the Commission now indicates for public and commercial buildings first an obligation to put solar panels on the roofs. That will boost, without any doubt, the application of solar and solar panels. And they will create an EU solar PV industry alliance. But what I have forgotten here, no mention of measures for the balancing in the whole paper. So they want to improve and they want to deploy more and more renewables. So that means higher level of volatility. That also means that we need the power for the balancing. not one word, how we organize the balancing markets. Biomethane, the same scenario. The Commission announced to double the targets, now 35 BCM biomethane by 2030. Yes, it is important to do a strategy for biomethane. Biomethane is some product for me that needs to be developed. But what the Commission does is it has published an action plan. But if you look at this action plan, it comes in a second, what you see, there is no concrete commitment on actions that need to be taken, nothing. There's no timeline, there's no deadline, no schedule for actions. There's nothing, it's just words. And here it is. I don't go into it. Just to say, yes, biomethane is a sector that we have to develop. Yes, we have to make sure that biomethane can find also its way to the wholesale market. So not only on from the distribution grid, it has to go and has to be access to the transmission grid. Yes, that needs to be done. But where's the action? It has to be ruled on, has to be regulated on. Nothing is in there. Energy efficiency, I skip yet because I'm a bit over time. You can see again, energy efficiency, the target will be increased from 9 to 13%. The same story, energy efficiency in the last 20 years has not worked. We had all the targets and only by manipulation we have reached the 2020 target. So again, wishful thinking, and the actions that are proposed are not leading to the fulfillment of these targets. Financing. Of course, all this costs a lot of money, and the Commission provides 300 billion euros. That's a number, isn't it, for the implementation only of this Repower EU. But then let's have a look what the Commission does. The Commission refers to the resilience and recovery facility that was installed to combat the COVID pandemic. After. Now, the Commission says, okay, we will now open under this facility a new chapter with new action to deliver on the Repower EU objectives, and member states can then put the measures from the Repower under this window and can then make use of the facility. At the same time, and now it comes, the Commission says, and there are 225 billion available in loans. There were 360 billion in loans in the facility, and member states until now were not interested to get the loans. Now the Commission says, okay, we have 225 billion left, so I offer it to you again. Why should it work this time better than the first time? I don't know. Real measures are grants delivered through the EU ETS. 20 billion, that's a real measure. New grants from transfer from structural funds, mainly cohesion policy and common agricultural policy, that's a concrete measure. I skipped that here because I want to come to my last slide before I conclude. And that is here. What Xavier has raised. Intervention of the market. Let me be crystal clear. I am a defender, at least on the wholesale market, on a free market. And I think that we have succeeded over the last decades to establish in electricity and specifically also in gas, functioning European integrated markets. And one should think twice before you go into a wholesale market, new market design for wholesale markets. What does the Commission think about it? On the gas market intervention, they want to address the causes of the crisis. EU energy platform, I have mentioned. They give now a blanket acceptance that member states can regulate gas prices, not only for vulnerable consumers, as it was already the case, but for everybody, all households and businesses. Whether that is the right thing to do, I don't know. And then something that I have not yet understood how they want to do it, emergency liquidity support measures, but nowhere they mention what these support measures should be. And I cannot, I have not the imagination to see how you can do that. Then there is a specific case, and that is, what if Gazprom, Russia, says today, no gas? You can imagine what will happen to the gas prices. Here, the Commission said it will consider the possibility of price caps. This is also the only ultima ratio measure that I could accept, because the gas caps that were in the discussion are very, very bad. As I said, the wholesale market should remain intact. On the electricity market intervention, here we have heard the Spanish model that the Commission apparently has accepted, but the first day was not very promising, was it? The prices, electricity prices, are even higher than before. So thank you very much, because with such a system where you have to add the compensation at the end, it will not work. It will simply not work. But okay, that's Spanish cuisine. And then the last one is long-term market design reforms, and this is an interesting one. This is an interesting one because Xavier has said that. I think that in the electricity market design, we have just reformed it in 2019, but I personally do believe that one should put the best experts together, not only commission, experts from the industry, from think tanks, from, why not NGOs, happy to take them on board, to think, how do we need to develop the electricity market design in the future? And one of the critical points that need to be addressed is the marginal pricing system, because that is what has caused the problem with high gas prices, and gas prices are influencing the rest. So this is definitely something one should look at, but by in kind of open discussion with experts and not in Brussels in some dubious corners. So that is that, and let me conclude. Now, first conclusion, I was thinking, what impact has this all now on the European climate targets? First, I think it is a positive impact, is that I see an acceleration of moving away from fossil fuels more into renewable energy. I think it will not happen as fast as the Commission thinks, but it will happen, in my view, between 2028 and 2035. We will have an acceleration, and as Xavier said, we will also see an acceleration of development of new technologies, and that will help. So this is definitely good. New role of nuclear energy, I will not go into it. We can, if there's interest, we can discuss it. There will be a timing problem for the short-term 2030 targets, and you have already heard what I said. All the new targets through the Repower EU, where the Fit for 55 targets were again increased, in my view, they are not achievable. They are not achievable because it is just a target setting without real impact assessments, as I have said, on the three objectives. It is just a political wishful thinking, a political aspiration that they say we should go there. Okay, I can accept that, but they should not then dream and think that these targets will be achieved by the measures that they have proposed. What does it mean for the 2050? Here I am convinced that we are still on the path towards the fulfillment, achievement of the 2050 net zero target. The only thing where I have a difficulty is when I see the policymakers, talking now from Brussels, what they do, they are already in 2050. They are looking now to our situation today, and now they pull the whole thing to 2050. That is done with these targets that they propose, the Commission. But what they should do, they should start from today, looking to 2050, and incrementally look what kind of concrete measures are possible so that I can get to my target. That's the big difference. And that all culminates into my commissary policy approach. What I see in Brussels, what is happening, is that we have policy-driven evidence. The politicians, they decide the targets, and the evidence is because they have said it. The right thing would be evidence-driven policy, that you start with the analysis, impact assessment, to see how can I converge the three objectives, and starting from there, developing then the right policy. Sorry for being a bit over time. Thank you very much.
Now the floor is for Hannon.
Thank you. So my name is Hannon Rasool, and I'm the Deputy Director of the Fuels and Transportation Division at the California Energy Commission. The California Energy Commission was created in 1974, and we're the primary energy policy and planning agency for the state. We were created in response to the energy crisis and growing energy demand. And so our edict at that time was forecasting electricity demand and really focusing on efficiency standards. We're made up of five commissioners, and they're appointed by the governor but confirmed by the Senate, serve five-year terms with no term limit, and each one has a specialty. So we have a commissioner who's an expert in law, one in economics, one in environment, one in science. And our mission is very clear. So I spent about 11 years in the utility space, last 2 years with the Energy Commission. And again, it's a very clear goal that we have: clean, affordable, and reliable energy supply for California on the way to 100% zero emission throughout the state. This is not just electricity production. This is 100% carbon-free across all aspects of California. So the Energy Commission has grown quite a bit since 1974. We have several different divisions. I lead the Fuels and Transportation Division, so we make a lot of investments in zero emission vehicle infrastructure. And then my counterparts have different areas as well. So we do a lot of state energy policy and planning. We want to make sure that we use evidence-based policy. And so we actually look forward for all energy supplies, gas, electricity, and others. And this is called the Energy Assessment Division. They focus quite a bit on that. We also have a division that focuses on innovation. So we do a lot of funding on innovation. I'll speak about that a little bit later as well. We have a efficiency division, which focuses on appliances, but also building decarb, and a number of different areas that we focus on. And we're just one of many state agencies in California. So the Energy Commission, we have our purview. The Public Utility Commission focuses on overseeing gas and electric utilities, as well as other agencies as well. The Independent System Operator focuses on the macro transmission level need. And the Air Resources Board focuses on many areas as well to reduce air pollution, including the transportation space. So we work quite a bit with them on zero emission vehicle regulations. And I want to note, so California is the fifth largest economy in the world. And so oftentimes the policies we make have a large impact on how the market reacts. And we've actually grown our GDP over time quicker than the rest of the United States, even with strong regulations and strong environmental goals. And this is one of my favorite slides. It's a little bit dated at this point, but our GDP has increased, our population has increased, our greenhouse gas emissions have come down overall. They've come down even more significantly per capita and per GDP. Next, let me talk a little bit about the policies which underpin all of this. There's a number of actions that happen at the governor level through executive order. We also have a lot of state laws and also regulations by different agencies. Executive Order B-5518 by Governor Brown set a carbon neutrality goal of 2045. Again, I want to note, this is not just electricity generation. This is carbon neutrality across the board and net negative thereafter. Senate Bill 100 put into law that we must be 100% clean electricity by 2045. And I'll talk about that in a moment too. There's some interim goals as well. And I think interim goals are exceedingly important. It's great to be ambitious. It's great to have a target for 2045 or 2050. But unless you have measurable goals that entities are accountable to along the way, it's really difficult to say whether you're gonna get there or not. And so we have interim goals as part of that as well. Executive Order N7920 says that so starting in 2035, there will be no more gas car sales in California. So if you own a gas car, great, keep it, keep driving it. You can even sell it on the used market. No one's taking anyone's property away, but we will not sell combustion vehicles in California on the passenger side starting in 2035. And I'll speak about that a little bit further as well. And also we have a lot of other environmental goals. They're not listed here, but one that I'm fond of is we'll protect 30% of our land and water by 2030 as well. So there's a really strong conservation angle to this as well. And this is probably different here in Spain, in the EU, and even in the United States as a nation, there's a different mix here. But in California, 41% of our greenhouse gas emissions are from transportation. And it's actually more like 50% when you include the upstream production of fuel that supports transportation. That's in the industrial bucket there, but it's really 50% of the California problem, greenhouse gas-wise, is from transportation. So there's a really strong focus on that. And it's a stubborn area too. So in the last 20 years, the emissions from transportation have only come down 7%, industrial only come down 8%, and we need to do better there. On decarbonizing the grid, we're down 44%. So that's done a lion's share of the work, and we expect it to do even more, again, per executive order and per state law. All right, next I'm gonna talk a little bit of these different sectors, different categories that we're focused on. Achieving 100% clean electricity in California, that's a Senate Bill 100 one I mentioned. And so it does a number of things. It sets a 2045 goal of powering all retail electricity sales by zero carbon. And I want to note that zero carbon is different than renewable. So renewable energy, at least as defined in California, solar, wind, small hydro, nuclear is not considered renewable because there's an environmental impact on the waste side of that. And large hydro is not considered renewable because it has an impact to the environment when we dam water. But those are considered zero carbon. Those will be used towards these end goals. And we also updated the renewable portfolio standard through this law. We set at least 60%, and this must be renewable by 2030. And you know, this is what's interesting. When I worked at the utility, the first renewable energy mandate was, let's say, 10 or 15%. And all the grid operators and all the engineers said, I don't know how we're gonna do it. 10%, that's crazy. It's all intermittent, there's no way we can do it, the grid's gonna fail. We got there, early. We've kept doing more and more and more. And now people worry about that last 5 or 10%. But I think all too often people's reactions are, oh, it's new, we don't know how to do this. But we have to. Like, these are real. Climate change is real. And unless we set these targets and really put the effort behind it, we're never going to get there. So we've set these targets. We've set checkpoints along the way. And we've even increased them. So Senate Bill 100 increased the target for 2030 because we were already well on the way to that goal. So Senate Bill 100 came out in 2018. We did our first assessment in 2021. With a few other state agencies. And our initial analysis suggests that this is technically achievable through multiple pathways. We're gonna have to do a lot of investment. We're gonna have to make a lot of investments both on renewables and also stationary energy storage. That is gonna be a big focus for us as well. And we also found that retaining some natural gas capacity will minimize the cost. But again, we're gonna iterate on this every 3 to 4 years and see how to phase that out completely. In the electricity sector. That is our goal. There's some additional analysis we'll do as well. I'm gonna skip this in the interest of time. All right, so progress to 100% clean electricity. In 2013, we were already at 41% zero carbon. In 2020, we're at 60% zero carbon. So again, these are achievable. You know, we're at 60% as of 2 years ago. This is not impossible. It's not some, you know, magical feat that can't happen. We're well on our way. Right now, our renewable energy mix is majority solar. And then that wind portion is all land-based. We don't actually have any offshore wind today on the West Coast, but we are actually making some very large investments in that in the future as well. And as I noted, you know, we're very realistic about the challenge ahead of us. Our renewable production must be 3x of what it is today, and our storage investments and capacity must be 8x of what it is today. But again, it's achievable. We're moving towards that. In 2019, we had 250 megawatts of stationary storage. In 2020, we added about another 200 megawatts. Last year, we added 2,000 megawatts. And this year, we're slated to add another 2,000. And actually, that number is a little bit low now. It could be upwards of 3,000 or 4,000 new megawatts of stationary energy storage this year alone. And you know, look, California's really proud of what we've done to lead the way here. So the world's largest geothermal plant, 955 megawatts, is in California. The world's largest solar PV is in California as well, Apple headquarters. The world's largest battery energy storage system at Moss Landing is also in California. And I'll note, when we first did that one, it took a long time to do the development, to do the permitting, and all the planning that went around it. Each iteration, we get better and faster at it. Okay, so this, I think, is probably one of the most important points I want to bring up today. Climate change makes it harder to fight climate change. I mean, we talk about costs, right? One of the bigger costs in California is mitigating wildfire risk. You know, there was a time when you could have wooden posts. Now we have to harden, we have to fire harden that. We have to steel posts. That's more expensive. We have to underground distribution and transmission in a way that we didn't have to before. That is significantly more expensive to underground it. But that's what we have to do in the face of climate change. We have more and more regional heat waves that last a really long time. They're not isolated, they're regional, and they last much longer than they ever did before. Drought is seriously impacting our ability to do hydro in a way that people did not expect that 10 years ago. So we're already having to reassess our planning based upon climate change. And then the wildfires are massive in California. There was a time when we considered it wildfire season. And you know, that time we got our fire fleets staffed up. It was a bit of a seasonal approach there. It's all the time now. We have wildfires pretty much year round. And that's not limited to California. We see it all over the US and all over the world. And these are the real impacts of our inaction for the last how many decades. And so I know the challenge ahead of us is hard, but there's always going to be a reason not to do it. And all the reasons we chose not to do it before is why we're in the situation today. 3.7 million acres were burned in 4 years in wildfires in California. In 1 year alone, we eclipsed that, 4.2 million acres just in 2020. So again, people are starting to feel the impacts of climate change in a real meaningful way. This is happening in people's lives. It's not some esoteric thing in the future. And I think this is an important slide as well. You know, often we talk about greenhouse gases and climate change, and that is the right conversation to have. But I think sometimes we don't talk about the other benefits of this transition. We will improve local health by these investments. So it's important not to conflate greenhouse gases and climate change with local air pollution from diesel particulate matter, from power plants, and from transportation. That causes cancer, that causes asthma, that causes a lot of medical risks. And unfortunately, that is disproportionately borne on low-income and disadvantaged communities. So making these investments in this transition is an equity decision as well. I'm really proud that 50% of the portfolio that we invest in the transportation group will be deployed to help low-income and disadvantaged communities. Because too often, that's where power plants are built. That's where transmission lines are built. That's where highways are built. And that disproportionately affects certain pockets of our population. I mean, it's a sad fact that your zip code will determine your life expectancy. And that is really not an okay thing to have in a civilized society, in my opinion. And then really, I think an important point of this too is that it's good for the economy. These are jobs of the future. We're making huge investments in local jobs and manufacturing. All right, so we back all this up between both regulations and investments. So I think the regulation piece is extremely important. We need to set targets, we need to be realistic about them, we need to set them, we need to be ambitious, and we need to really hold people to account based on those regulations. But we also need to make investments to make that transition happen equitably and quickly. So the next few slides, I'm going to talk about the governor's budget for the California Energy Commission. Again, we're just one state agency. There's a lot of money being invested to other state agencies as well. So I'm going to focus on the Energy Commission investment. $6.2 billion in this year's budget alone for the Energy Commission. $2 billion to my division for zero emission vehicle infrastructure. $1.8 billion for clean energy and building decarbonization. And then $2.4 billion for energy resiliency. All right, I lost my slides. Oh, fantastic, thank you. And then $2.4 billion for energy resiliency. And this is where I need my crutch, because I'm, again, on the zero emission vehicle side and the energy package and reliability package. Oh, perfect. Great, thank you. So I'm going to come back to this slide at the end. I'll do a bit of a deeper dive on the transportation side, but let me come back to this slide in a bit. But the governor's budget, we're investing $900 million in building decarbonization. Again, this is where the regulations will help remedy it going forward. So we have strong building codes going forward, but these investments are for what's already deployed out there. So we know we need to do a lot of retrofits. $900 million for building decarbonization, $380 million for long duration storage, $100 million for green hydrogen. And again, like, I think we need to have an honest conversation of where hydrogen comes from. The majority of hydrogen today is from fossil fuel production, right? So we use fossil fuel and we create hydrogen through that. There is an environmental impact to that. It is a small portion of hydrogen production today that is truly green. So we'll make investments in green hydrogen as well. $200 million in industrial decarb, and then additional money on offshore wind and some other areas. Another $2.4 billion incremental to that on reliability, because we know that's really important as well. So $1.2 billion for reliability assets, $1 billion in innovation grants through our EPIC program, which I'll speak about in a moment, $100 million for direct air carbon capture, and then additional investments on top of that as well. Okay, so let me talk a little bit, and the way I've structured this is I'll speak about some of the different divisions within the Energy Commission. A lot of what we do is grant funding, and the way we structure this is we do a very public stakeholder process to determine how and where to invest, and we set up a solicitation. Typically what we'll do is say we'll pay for 50% of a project, or we'll pay for 80% of a project, and we go out and we ask people to apply to the application phase for our grants. They'll put together an application, we will score it, and then we'll fund the projects going down the list, highest scoring all the way down. And so that's a really great way for us to leverage our public dollars with private investments as well. The EPIC program does a lot with transportation, batteries and storage, hydrogen, and emerging tech. And if I wasn't the director of the transportation group, this is a group I'd want to be head of, because they do amazing products. It's a lot of seed investments across the board. Small startups, in-state California, manufacturing, software, job creation. And a lot of this has paid back quite well for the state as well. We also do a lot with industrial decarb. Again, this is a really challenging area. So we have a lot of different strategies, including DERs, energy efficiency, different materials. But again, this is something we have to tackle, and we have a division that focuses on industrial decarbonization. Energy efficiency is one that I'm really proud of as well. This has its own division as well, as you can imagine. They focus quite a bit on appliances and also building decarb. We put in place some of the most aggressive building codes. And it's not an all-electric building code. It actually requires the panel capacity to support all electric and certain endpoints to be electric. And so we haven't completely banned gas from new buildings, but we've put in something that highly encourages electric. And each building code, we do incrementally more. So in the past, we required every new home built in California must have solar rooftops. For commercial businesses, solar and stationary storage as well. And then again, we're moving forward towards an all-electric code. And what's amazing to me is we're not even the most progressive in this sometimes. There are cities in California who through local ordinances are saying, we don't want gas in the new homes that are built anymore. And those are withstanding legal challenges, and they're moving to all electric codes in certain jurisdictions. And I think California is headed in that way too on the building side. And energy efficiency works in California. So starting in 1970 or so, you know, it's not completely flat. We've seen some increase in production per household, but not a lot. The US is almost twice as high as us because they haven't embraced energy efficiency as much as California had. And again, this is in our building codes. It's required. And it saves people money, right? So we do a cost-benefit analysis when we do these codes, and we have to show that even if the upfront cost is slightly more, the overall savings to the consumer is quite a bit more. So over $1 billion in consumer savings because of our efficiency standards. We also have a renewable energy group, and they focus on the renewable energy portfolio standard, also informing consumers about where their electricity is coming from. So depending which utility territory you're under, it gives you a code which shows how much electricity is coming from different sources. And they also provide incentives for rooftop solar for some of the legacy stock that's out there. So I mentioned offshore wind earlier. We have traditionally not done a lot with offshore wind, and that is something we are remedying, and we're going to remedy very soon here. So we have gone through a long process of working with the federal government and local and state governments, as well as tribes, and we are ready to start deploying offshore wind. This is about 20 miles off the coast, floating offshore wind. And we're expecting about 5 gigawatts of lease auctions later this year. So we'll plan to have at least 3,000 megawatts by 2030 with 10 to 15,000 megawatts by 2045. And again, I mean, something I'm really proud about California, we set these goals and oftentimes we exceed them. So my expectation is actually higher numbers than this. And this is a great opportunity for us. You know, there is a real need to balance these different sources. And for us, we have a ton of solar, but I think we all know how that curve goes with solar. And so we need to actually keep adding wind as well. We have a fair amount of land-based wind, but with this offshore wind, again, 20 miles off coast, much more consistent wind supply, will be really beneficial to our transition to that under Senate Bill 100, also with those massive stationary energy storage investments. We also have a group that focuses on emergency preparedness. This is our energy assessment division. I won't go too deep into this, but what I will say is they work with the utilities and other state agencies to plan for contingencies, right? Something's always gonna come up. And in our case, we're planning for, what if an entire transmission line got knocked out by a wildfire? That's happened. We've had to de-energize the transmission line. What if a drought causes less hydro? So we plan for all these contingencies. Doesn't mean we're always going to get it right. It doesn't mean there's always going to be a perfect outcome, but we're thinking about the short term and the long term. And again, we have a division that focuses on energy assessment. I mentioned earlier the economic opportunity from this transition. So we have a really great resource associated with one of our geothermal plants where lithium is actually a byproduct of geothermal creation there. When they do the geothermal, lithium comes up in a slurry with it. And this is one of the most environmental friendly means to get lithium. This is not mining, nor is it evaporation pools. This is actually a product that we can just kind of pull out of it. We're fortunate to have this in our backyard. So we're making massive investments with the private industry as well. So a lot of private investments coming to actually withdraw the lithium from that. And right now we're estimating we could supply about 1/3 of the global need of lithium from Lithium Valley. And so this is a resource we definitely want to do a lot to have domestic in-state manufacturing of battery packs and cells. Again, so the natural gas transition, we've very much done a study on how to get natural gas out of our electricity system, but there is an incumbent gas system as well. So this year into next year, we're going to be doing a lot of analysis to see how do we actually move away from the gas system in a way that respects stranded assets and is equitable to all. But again, we're looking at each sector and being really mindful and thoughtful through analysis to figure out how to get to zero emission across the board. But with this, there's also opportunities. So we're looking quite a bit at green hydrogen to see how can that be a part of our portfolio for things like grid support, long duration storage, also hard to electrify industrial applications will be really important for hydrogen, as well as some of the transportation sector. A lot of the investments we make today is for on-road vehicles, both passenger light duty vehicles, also trucks and buses. But we know we also want to do more with marine, aviation, and locomotive. And so we think hydrogen could have a strong play over there. Just last year, we invested in a hydrogen switcher car locomotive and also hydrogen marine craft, a ferry. So we see some more opportunities there. Okay, so for the last bit of my presentation, I will speak about the transportation sector. So I'll try not to go too in the weeds here, but this is kind of my favorite topic because it is such a big part of the problem. And it's difficult. I mean, these are difficult problems and they're fun to work on. So the problem for us in California is that approximately 50% of the greenhouse gas emissions come from transportation. And about 90% of diesel particulate matter comes from trucks and buses, right? Comes from transportation, comes from goods movement. I mentioned this already, so I'll just skip past this. And you know, I want to emphasize again, there is a disproportionate impact based upon your income, and minority communities as well are more impacted by transportation emissions. And the solution for us is zero emission transportation. And this is not something that is, you know, way off in the future. It is here today. We have the technology to do it. Been about 12, 13 years in the energy space. The last 5 or 6 years, I've been focused solely on zero emission transportation. And at that time, 5 years ago, it's not very long ago, people said, we will never have zero emission semi trucks. We're never gonna be able to do it. And they're like, oh yeah, I guess we can do it now. I mean, just in a couple years, the narrative has changed so quickly because there are massive private investments. The cost of batteries have come down 90% in the last 10 years. And that's the most expensive component of those vehicles. Energy density keeps increasing on a fairly predictable pace. And so we know we need to get to zero emission. Now let me talk a little bit deeper about the investments. Before I talked about the Energy Commission investments across the board, $2 billion is the Energy Commission investments just on the transportation side and just on the infrastructure side. So we work quite a bit with our sister agencies on other components of this as well. And let me actually jump to the next slide and I'll come back. So it was actually $10 billion over 5 years, multi-agency. Portion of that comes to the Energy Commission. We do the incentives for infrastructure deployment. A good share of that goes to the Air Resources Board. They do the rebates for vehicles, both passenger vehicles, also trucks and buses. So we partner with them quite a bit to do the infrastructure side and the vehicle side. There's also other investments here, $1.5 billion just for school buses. We're making a $1.5 billion investment to convert school buses to all electric school buses and the associated infrastructure as well. And so that's $10 billion over 5 years. But taking a step back at the Energy Commission side, this is that infrastructure component. What we're seeing is that there are more and more vehicle options, right? So again, 4, 5, 6 years ago, it was Tesla. Maybe there was a Leaf out there, you might see a Bolt, but really Tesla was the vehicle out there. And it changed the narrative on what zero emission vehicles could be. But since then, we've moved quite a bit. There's gonna be 150 different models available of electric vehicles in North America. So the biggest bottleneck ahead of us is infrastructure and equitable access to infrastructure. Because right now, at least in California, those who live in single family homes with garages, you can get an electric vehicle today, plug it in each night, just like your cell phone, and it is seamless. It's quite easy. But how do we help those who are in low-income communities who don't own their home? They might be renters. How do we help those who live in multi-unit dwellings, like apartments and condos? How do we help those in rural communities who just have a very different calculus in a rural community versus an urban community? And so we look at all of that through infrastructure. And the investments we're looking to make, I'll note we got $1.165 billion last year, mostly for infrastructure, $250 million for manufacturing grants. This $2 billion would be incremental to last year's $1.165. And this would be $600 million for publicly accessible DC fast chargers. We're looking to do, typically, the old legacy stuff's about 50 kW. We're looking to do 150, 200, 350 kW chargers, but with some kind of grid support as well, because we know that the load profile of these can be quite peaky. And so we want to either put stationary storage with it, put some software like automated load management to help have it be less impactful to the grid. We also have 300 million on equitable at-home charging. Again, the most convenient way to charge your vehicle is at home. It's more grid friendly because it's often level two charging. It's cheaper because you don't have the demand charges. So it's quite a bit cheaper than having to rely solely on public charging, at least in the US. I'm not sure what your structure is out here. But then also $250 million on drayage trucks. Drayage is a term that even people in California are not all familiar with, but essentially what a drayage truck is, it's a large semi-truck that moves back and forth between ports of entry. So be it Port of Long Beach, Port of LA, the marine ports, or land ports like the US-Mexico border, these vehicles go unload goods and they move to a warehouse, maybe 10, 20, 30 miles away. And they just go back and forth. They're often run on diesel, and they're often the oldest Class 8 semi-vehicles out there. So we're going to convert. Last year's goal with the budget was 1,000. This will help us get even more of those drayage trucks converted in the coming years. A targeted investment in transit buses, because again, those vehicles are here today. Like, no one needs new technology to do it. We can go do that today. Also, large investments in the ports, which will supplement and complement the drayage one. And then 100 million in emerging opportunities. And this is where we've had a lot of stakeholders come to us and say, we have an aviation project, we have a marine project, we have a locomotive project. We typically, because of the way our funding is constructed, have not been able to help them out with infrastructure. Emerging opportunities would allow us to do that. Also some investments in vehicle grid integration pilots. In the interest of time, I will not go too deep into VGI or some of the bidirectional stuff that is coming out in the market, but it's actually really fascinating and really interesting. And to where the private market has done an amazing job of providing the functionality through some of their offerings. All right, so quickly I'll go through some of our targets. We want to get to 1.5 million EVs sold by 2025. We hit 1 million late last year. Our goal is to have 250,000 chargers installed in that same timeline. We have about 85,000 chargers now, but we actually think we will hit that 250,000 target, partly from last year's budget and then some of our incumbent funding as well. We think we're well on the path to that. 200 hydrogen stations at the same time. We might miss that by about a year. We think we'll have 200 of those stations up by 2026. And those are just the public stations. Those don't speak to the ones that are behind the fence on a depot for a transit agency. And then goals for 5 million sold. And I mentioned this earlier on the executive order. So starting in 2035, we will not sell gas cars in California anymore. No new gas cars. Again, if you own one, you can sell what you already have in the secondhand market. But what's really interesting to me is the truck and bus side. Now, those targets of 2035 for drayage and off-road and 2045 for the rest of the fleet is not about new vehicle sales. It's about everything operating in California. So for those ones, our goals are that actually by 2045, it won't just be new sales. It'll be every truck and bus operating in the state will be zero emission. Again, in the interest of time, I won't get too much into this, but we've been doing this for a long time. You know, our first zero emission mandates were in 1990. I'm not even sure there were that many cars available at that time. But even then, we knew we had to deal with a transportation problem. You know, it was climate change, it was greenhouse gases, but it was also the air we breathe. The smog problem in LA was awful. And people saw it, people lived with it. And so these regulations, we've been putting them in place for decades. And so where we are today has been incremental steps. You know, we were chatting about this last night. Ambition is great. These big optimistic targets are fantastic, but you need incremental steps to get there. It's not gonna happen overnight. And we need to be really mindful of setting those goals along the way and hitting them best we can. There's another regulation I won't talk about too much. So again, we're exceeding our goals. Last year, 12% of new vehicle sales in California were zero emission. It's about 1 in 7, 1 in 8 vehicles. First quarter of this year, it was 16.3%, if memory serves, which is about 1 in 6 vehicles sold today are zero emission. Those are exceeding the targets that we had set. I'm gonna skip past some of these vehicle to grid ones in the interest of time. So let me finish real quick by talking about the investments. Again, we think it's really important not just to make the transition through regulation and incentives, but it's really important that we build an economy around it, that we're mindful about the jobs, that we create or are lost in the transition. And we have 43 zero emission vehicle related manufacturers just in California. And this is across the entire chain. These are vehicle producers, these are infrastructure producers, these are electric vehicle batteries, these are drivetrains and components. We have 43 ZEV manufacturers today in the state. And similarly on the battery side, we're looking at every aspect of that supply chain and seeing where we can play in it, where we can make investments, where we can bring that manufacturing and job creation to California, and also support good paying jobs. So with that, I will close. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present today.
I think those have been extremely good and informative presentations. We have several questions from the audience, but before that, let me abuse my position as moderator and ask some questions of my own before transmitting the questions from the audience. One, it's a very general one, but I think it may be important. We know that climate change is a global phenomenon, but we have been talking, and your basically your presentations address local, although big issues in California and Europe, but we know the solution has to be global. And in particular, I have not heard in your presentations a lot about carbon pricing, neither about potential carbon adjustment tariffs or tax to prevent these leakages when carbon pricing is it's implemented in a certain region. I know that the industry in Europe and in other places sometimes complains of higher costs of competing with not such green competitors. So what do you think about this issue? What should be done? So how can we do our part, but at the same time move globally towards the objectives of the green transition?
Maybe I start here and give the European perspective. As you know, I think the European Union in the last COP26 round, where this the creation of carbon markets globally were one of the issues not solved, unfortunately, where the EU were very much behind and also trying to get partners. And the European Union at the moment is trying now to set up bilateral carbon markets. And on top of that, and that is a kind of instrument also to incentivize international partners to move into carbon markets, is our carbon border adjustment mechanism that the Commission has proposed. It is currently with the EU legislator, the European Parliament and the Council. And you might have heard last week, it was suspended. They could not find a positive vote on this carbon border adjustment mechanism because it is linked, of course, to the ETS system. And here again, within the European Parliament, you have two big groups. One group says it's not ambitious enough what you are doing, and the other saying it is too ambitious. So it is a bit up in the air, but my view is, yes, I think we should use also the energy diplomacy stronger in order to start with a bilateral agreements on the carbon markets, because that would then also lead to let down the carbon border adjustment mechanism, which in itself is a tricky instrument. For instance, what is proposed so far has a very, very limited scope of application. And also, it is not yet clear how it will look at the end, but there is the danger also with the compatibility with the WTO rules, especially if, as some member states are requesting, the idea of the Commission was the free allowances under the emission trading system will be replaced by the carbon border adjustment, and the member states want both. And if you give both, you have a problem with the subsidy code under the WTO. That's a bit where we are. But Xavier, I agree with you. It is a very important issue, and it will go back also on the agenda of the next COP meetings.
Thank you. Hannon, do you want to chip in the...
Yeah, I can briefly opine on that. So we actually have a cap and trade regime within California that is not US-wide, but we do have a cap and trade program within California, and also a low carbon fuel standard, which looks at fuel production and the carbon intensity of fuel production, ratcheting it down over time. And those are actually really valuable funding sources for some of our programs as well. So we're funded through a number of different things, including cap and trade revenue. The general fund in California has been very good in the last couple of years. We've had a large surplus, which has helped pay for some of our stuff. And then also on the vehicle side, there's a $2 registration fee. So when you get your vehicle registered each year, $2 of that overall fee comes to investments as well. So I think the cap and trade regime, as well as others, have provided valuable revenue for us to fund a lot of the transition.
Very good. Thank you. This is clarifying. Let me pose another question to you both. At least Klaus Dieter has indicated that the Ukraine's war may accelerate, you know, the move to phase out fossil fuels and towards green technologies. But wouldn't this risk to increase another dependence on autocracies because they mostly control the rare earths and the green, so-called green metals, you know, needed for the green transition. I see from Hannon that there is some good news on lithium, at this Lithium Valley, as I have, in fact, as I have learned. But still, if we look at the global scene, aren't we going to be dependent on similar autocracies for the green transition?
The answer is definitely yes. Because we do not have all the ingredients that are needed in order to develop the new technologies. And there, I think, I mean, that is, of course, known by everybody. And again, maybe what we have lived through in the energy sector might help here, that now people, politicians, they are thinking a bit also to diversify the supplies, but you know, for certain metals and ingredients, it is not possible. There are only two or three, and Russia is still one of the most important ones, and China. Then you have a bit in South America, Latin America. So diversification is key there, and of course, what I sense in Europe, the idea also to develop batteries without lithium. And that's ongoing, and that's the right technologies, because what we need to do is to see that we create value chains where we have a lot of European content in. Although I also must say that we should not make the mistake to use now the energy or the climate transformation that is necessary to close our economy, that we become a kind of closed shop. We need the global trade, and it's nothing bad in it, but we have to diversify. And that is the lesson learned from what we are just living through in the gas and oil sector.
Yeah, and I'll quickly add to that. Yeah. Very well said. I think that's exactly right. It's about diversification and looking for new ways to do it. We live in a global economy now. That's not going to change. But how do we plan for this? How do we mitigate? How do we diversify? And on the rare earth metal component, you know, there are battery technologies that are probably going to become mainstream in the next 5 to 10 years that do not rely on the same chemistries as we do today, including solid state batteries, ones with different anodes and cathodes. And, you know, I think the innovation that can happen in batteries is amazing. Like, gas cars are not going to get any better. We've been doing that for a long time. They're probably as good as they're going to get. Not a lot of innovation in some of these incumbent industries. There is a ton of innovation in the new industries. And a lot of people are very smart coming up with new chemistries, and they're going to make a lot of money doing it. And so I think those who are looking towards the future in these investments are looking a lot healthier than those who are unwilling to change.
And we are still dreaming of the fusion energy that would solve all of our problems.
You got to diversify, right? You got to toss that in the mix.
Thank you. Just a follow-up a question on, and then I will give, I will provide the questions from the floor. In transportation, is the, because it's key, obviously, right? Is the electric vehicle the only game in town? That's to say, do we have to put, we don't have to diversify in this case, and that's to say, and just go for the electric vehicle because it's superior? Or do you envision potential alternative technologies which are also clean and that would help solve the transportation issue?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. So, you know, at least in California, it's zero emission. And we're not choosing electric over hydrogen or against something else that may come down the pipe. I would love more options, right? I think on the light duty passenger vehicle side, the market has spoken to a large degree. We see so much more investments globally in electric vehicles relative to hydrogen. Japan and South Korea have really kind of put a lot of eggs in that basket of hydrogen, but they're having to do massive incentives to get even not great uptake on the passenger vehicle side for hydrogen. So we are committed to keeping both avenues open in California. We're going to hit 200 stations for hydrogen in about 2026. That'll support approximately 290,000 light-duty hydrogen vehicles in California. Right now, we're at about 7,000 hydrogen and almost 1 million electric. And so after we deploy those 200 stations, let's see what the market does. But if the market doesn't respond with new vehicle offerings or some other things which really helps that market move forward, well, then I think the market has spoken to a large degree, because that's where the investments are going. It's a much more interesting conversation, I think, on the medium-duty, heavy-duty side, so trucks and buses, aviation, marine, and those. I think for that, the window for hydrogen is more open. Hydrogen is still a few years behind electric, even for those segments, as far as the capabilities and the production. But I think hydrogen is certainly in the conversation and a healthy debate, even among state agencies and private actors in California. So I'm pretty interested to see how that plays out in the next 4 to 5 years.
I could not agree more with what Hannon said. Unfortunately, that's not the situation in Europe, because in Europe, we are on a not technology open debate here. It is all going into electrification. And to my own surprise, even truck manufacturers have decided to use batteries. So EV vehicles, and that is a surprise to me, because I fully agree with Hannon that you should leave it open, and there are segments where hydrogen is a better source. For the urban region, for me, it is evident. Also the buses and the trucks for utilities, that in my view, if you are in a certain region where you can charge easily, it's fine. But I tell you a story. A friend of mine, he has a Tesla, and he went from Brussels to Switzerland. Normally it's a 7 to 8 hours drive. With his car, he had to stop three times. And the first stop he had, there were 20 cars in front of him. It was a fast charger, but it took him 2 hours to get his car charged. After 300 kilometers, he had to do exactly the same thing. And there it was not 20, but 10. So he lost
another. So all in all, he said, I will never take an electric car at this moment in time and go over a distance of 800, 900 kilometers. And that is, in my view, still a big, big problem that we have. That even if you have the charging facilities, it's not big enough. What I personally have not understood so far is, why do we not go for a system where we just change the battery? So you drive in, you give up your battery, you get a new one, and then you drive on. For me, it's just then a question of storing this, but you can recharge even during hours that are not so costly. But I don't know. I also underline what Hannon just said. We should leave it to the market. The market should decide what they want. We have to offer the technology, and we have to make it possible that those who want to develop these technologies, be it hydrogen, be it electric, that we give them the chance to get to the market, and then the market should decide in which direction it goes. And the past in the technology and development has shown that this is working. I mean, I remember when we started with the Betamax and all, we had five or six different systems, and at the end it was one. That's normal, and that is healthy in my view. And it's bad if the politicians decide what is the best for the people.
Indeed. In fact, Klaus-Dieter, you may remember that at the beginning of the 20th century, there was an option of an electric car versus the combustion engine. And in fact, the electric cars, they were working with your system. So the batteries were being replaced. So maybe we may go back to the beginning of the 20th century.
Xavier, you mentioned something. I mean, the EU is about to ban combustion engines by 2035. I'm pretty sure that this will be decided by the EU legislator. What I do not understand here is that they are not testing the ideas of still using combustion engine, but with synthetic fuels. I don't understand, because that is a solution that should be also open. What really matters is that I get a zero emission car, full stop. Yeah. And I should not determine beforehand and only with this single technology.
No, absolutely. And in fact, the example that you gave, just implies very clearly that we need a full network, no, a dense network of charging stations to make the electric car viable. In some countries, this is it's getting there. In some others, it's not, and so that's a main issue. In any case, so let me move to the many questions we have. One question I think is also motivated by what by some of your answers, but is more general. What's in general the role of tax incentives in the green transition? And I'm thinking just in one, but there are many. And one is, should the authorities subsidize the buying of a Tesla, for example, or of a high-end or relatively high-end electric car, or to achieve the objectives, it would be cheaper or more efficient to do it through other means. So, but that's just a specific example. So what's in general the role of tax incentives in the green transition?
Yeah, I can speak, you know, at least on the transportation side. I think we need all the tools we have at our disposal. Again, you know, something I said earlier, if we had taken climate change seriously before we were living through the impacts, we might not have to do all the measures we have to do. But the fact that we just kept kicking the can down the road, doing what was easiest and not dealing with things for quite a long time means we need all the tools we have. So I think tax incentives are part of that. And California has that for certain things, including promoting in-state manufacturing, because we want those jobs to come to us. But also on the vehicle component, right? So we do, on the Energy Commission, we pay for a portion of the infrastructure. The private market picks up the delta. And the Air Resources Board does vehicle incentives. But they revisit those incentives periodically. Initially, it was, you buy a zero emission vehicle, electric or hydrogen, we will give you a rebate. Doesn't matter what your income is, doesn't matter what the car value is, we'll give you the rebate. They have since refined that. And so now what they're saying, and I forget exactly where the dollar threshold is, but they're saying if you're buying a car over X amount of dollars, you don't get the rebate. So, you know, I want a Rivian, really want to get that Rivian electric truck. It's a $90,000 car, not something I'm buying anytime soon. But if I had the money to buy a $90,000 car, I probably don't need the $2,500 rebate. And so I think the Air Resources Board is being really mindful and saying, we want the money to influence behavior. We want someone who is considering an electric car to then say, with this rebate, I will get it. And that means a car of a certain price or below. And they're also looking at income caps as well. So again, if you're making $500,000 or $600,000 a year, you probably don't need a $3,000 incentive from the state. And so I think you have to be really nuanced in these both incentives and regulations and revisit them and refine them over time, because the market is changing so rapidly. Again, the conversation around zero emission vehicles 5 years ago is very different than it was 2 years ago and different than it is today. So I think we can be really nuanced and mindful in the way we provide incentives and we set regulations.
For me also, tax incentives are important, but as Hannon just said, what matters is how they are set up and that they are periodically reviewed so that they are targeted also to the right groups. And then the second thing, what I can say, currently also the energy taxation directive is under reform. And now the EU will introduce a complete new structure of the energy taxation with a ranking. There will be 8 different categories, and starting with the first category, that's only fossil fuel, and that gets the highest taxation. So it's a negative. You are punished if you are using fossil fuel pure, and then you have different categories, and the 8th category is then the zero emission, where you have the most advantaged tax rate. And here, the problem there, again, what I criticize on that proposal is that it is not directly linked to the savings of CO2, it is just on the production. And there, I think it doesn't end up. But these tax incentives are important. For instance, but it's done mostly by the member states. And in Belgium, for instance, what they are currently doing is they have for companies, for instance, they can, if they buy a car today and it's a hybrid car, they can 100% write it off from their taxes. From 2025 onwards, hybrid cars are gone, it's only electric cars. So these are the ways also where member states can have an impact. And I think if it is well designed, these incentives or anti-incentives, then I think they do well in the system.
Okay, thank you. So we have another question, which I think you've mentioned, but just in passing, which is nuclear energy. Is there a role for nuclear energy in the energy transition or even in the energy future? No, as the question poses, no, there are countries that have reopened this conversation and either taking nuclear on board, obviously France, but also the UK and other countries, no, in the future energy capacity mix. Also, there have been innovations in this technology. How do you see that?
The answer is yes, there's a role for nuclear energy. And even if a lot of people don't like it, or even some member states don't like it, in the European Union, there's a free choice of each member state of the composition of their energy mix. So all member states have the right to decide, I want to go into nuclear. And some countries like Poland, for instance, they are doing it. And when I look at the situation in Poland as an example, they are still 70% dependent on coal and lignite. So when we ask them to do their share in a decarbonization, what in the hell can they rely on? They cannot do it all with offshore wind or onshore wind or photovoltaic. They do certain things. They do natural gas.
And they will do also nuclear. And I don't see that if all the safety measures are fulfilled, I don't see something wrong with it. And take France as another example. They have decided to renew the whole nuclear fleet. They will reduce it, but they will still 50% of the energy will be from nuclear sources. And not only for producing electricity, but also using it for producing hydrogen. And it is a zero carbon source. So if, and it is a base load. So if you need something also stable in order to balance the volatility in the renewable system, then nuclear is a solution. You know that it is very, very, very disputed in Europe. There are some member states, Austria, Germany, Luxembourg, they are fiercely fighting against it. In the European Parliament, the whole Green Group, etc., are fighting it. You know the taxonomy delegated act that is currently under scrutiny there for a nuclear and natural gas might fail because two committees, the Economic Committee and the Environmental Committee, have voted against. Now, in order to stop this delegated act of the Commission, which sets the conditions under which natural gas and renewable can be taxonomy aligned, in order to make it fail, the Parliament needs a big majority, so an absolute majority. And we will see next month whether these groups in the Parliament will organize this absolute majority against this. Then nuclear and natural gas will be not taxonomy aligned, which means that it will be very, very difficult to find the investments on the markets because a lot of private and institutional investors, they want to have only actions that are taxonomy aligned.
Hannon, do you want to California perspective?
I'll take a pass on this one. So since I'm not fully briefed on all the nuclear components in California, and so when I was in the private industry, it was much easier for me to opine on these things. But as a state
official, I saw in your slide that you have 10.6%
today, right? But so there's been a couple nuclear plants that have been decommissioned in the last 10 years. We have Diablo Canyon, which is still online, but that's going to be taken offline in the coming years as well. So I think certainly at the stakeholder level, so I'm not talking about the state agencies or the California position, at the stakeholder level, even some environmental entities say, yes, we need nuclear because it's zero carbon and it's baseload. And then other environmental advocates say, no, there's a consequence to nuclear if things go bad and they don't want it. So there's certainly a debate among stakeholders, but I will not opine on California's ultimate position as a state representative, because I'm not fully briefed on that one. So I need to have some discipline there.
We have also the development of small and modular reactors, which is an interesting development, so that you do not have to have these big reactors. And another problem that we are facing has to do with Russia, because most of the reactors that we have already operating, be it in Finland, Czech Republic and others, are run with Russian fuels. And now the big question is, how can we replace that and what is needed in order to transform them so that they can take in non-Russian nuclear fuels?
Yes, very good. So I think we'll keep talking about this issue for a while. We have another question which I think it's very interesting. And the question is, why the difference in storage energy development between California and the EU? Are both regions using different definitions or different objectives or different phases? Are they in the different phases of development? So also I had the impression from your talks, you know, that Hannon, you are much more optimistic about storage than Klaus Dieter, but I don't know if this is true or not.
No, I don't think so. I'm not pessimistic on storage. On the contrary, I think the difference between California and the EU is the tradition, because traditionally we have a lot of underground gas storages in Europe. And what we are now trying to do is, because it's a very valuable asset, what we now try to do it, as with the gas pipelines, by the way, that we want to repurpose these underground storages to convert them also into hydrogen or biomethane storages. So that is something where, in my view, it's the right decision to look first what kind of assets, storage assets, do you have available in order to use and make use of it, because it has an economic value. And then, of course, you know that there's this battery alliance. Battery storage is also coming now to the within Europe to the forefront. And yeah, for me, it's again what we have already said with the vehicles. Let it go. Take hydrogen stationary equipment. Take batteries. I think it is the mixture of everything, and you have to find the right place where the technology has the highest efficiency. And I think there we are not so far apart. You are doing a lot with the batteries, as I've seen. I don't believe that in Europe we will see this kind of development, because, as I said, we have a huge basis of underground storages that we can use. But for storing electricity short-term, not seasonal storage, I think batteries are still unavoidable.
Yeah, and we've had to do it. I mean, like, let's be honest, we are committed to 100% renewable and zero carbon electricity, but it comes with challenges and having to look for new tools. So renewables are intermittent. It comes as a surprise to no one. And we need storage to back that up. And so that's something we committed to and have made progress on over time as well. But it was born by necessity to some degree, right? We didn't have as much offshore wind. We're going to remedy that. That should help create some balance to it. But to us, that stationary storage piece is extremely important. And again, I'm just amazed at how quickly we're doing it. When I worked for the utility, we were doing very small storage projects, you know, 3 megawatts, 4 megawatts. And we got excited about it. And we didn't even know, do we define that as a grid asset or do we define it as generation? And so that whole debate happened of how do you even view this new asset that we haven't really considered before. But yet, you know, as we need to do more of it, we find economies of scale. Like I said, the price has come down 90% in the last 10 years. And when I was at the utility, we would even get bids from developers who said, we can do it for this much per megawatt hour today. And we're so confident in that cost curve, we can do it for this if we build it 4 years from now. And they were willing to enter into contracts knowing the trajectory of that. So, again, I think there's so much space to innovate and to add these assets to our grid. And, you know, we were thinking we'd get 2,000 megawatts this year. Just a week ago, I'm hearing it could be 3,000 or 4,000 megawatts this year. But again, it's somewhat of a necessity. You know we need to do it to incorporate all the renewables that we want to get onto the grid.
Okay, thank you. So my impression is that we need still a lot of innovation in battery storage to be able to be completely clean in 2050. So I am no expert, but that's my impression. Let me pose another question. This is more European or even I would say Iberian, but I think it's a concern that many people have here today. I think firms and consumers, no, and it's related to the cap on the gas price to generate electricity in Spain and Portugal that has been recently introduced. The aim, you know, is to try to reduce the price in the wholesale electricity market. The first day was not a success, okay, so that's, but that's also maybe for other reasons, no? Now, the question is, what implications this will have for the integrated European market and how this, you think, probably this is for Klaus Dieter, right? The export of electricity up to the level of the interconnection level, no? How will affect the market, how compensations will work to the gas generators, no, with this exported energy at the cap price, etc. So this friction generated by this cap, how do you see it being either resolved or developing, and with the perspective of the integrated the market, the wholesale electricity market in Europe? Mm.
Look, let me start with the impact on the internal energy market. Here, I think the Spanish model has taken the necessary steps by introducing a two-step auction system, so that all the energy that comes cross-border has its own auction. That's the first auction, and then only the second one, and that's more than internal domestically for Spain and Portugal. So therefore, this has been taken into account in the design of the model. The problematic thing, what I could see, is if this Spanish-Portuguese model would be duplicated by too many member states, because that might then have a negative impact on the functioning also of the European wholesale market. Now, when it comes to the Iberian Peninsula, my biggest concern was when I saw it in the first time, because in the first drafts that I saw, they have also foreseen that you would apply this to long-term contracts. And I think that has been, but correct me, that has been removed, because if that would stay, then you destroy all incentives to go into long-term contracts. And especially long-term contracts are important in order to keep prices in check. And but I think it was removed, I hope at least. And to the system itself, yeah, I think you are right. You should not judge it, the whole model, on the basis of one day experience. But as I said already, from the outset, to say, okay, I set a reference price for the gas so that then the electricity producers, they're using natural gas, have a normal gas price. I think it's 40 or 50 euros. From the outset, that's fine. But then the difference has to be compensated, and it comes on top of that. And here, I think the system cannot work. I don't see how it will work, but I'm the first to look into the next week's developments and to see how it works. Look, I mean, it is a very, very difficult question, and I do not blame member states looking into this, because let us be clear, there are windfall profits through the high energy prices. That is absolutely one thing. And with the marginal pricing system, where gas prices set the wholesale market price, with a devastating impact on renewable prices, is an issue that we have to look at. And therefore, I said, for me, that would be something one should now look whether for the future one could not develop a better system. As long as we have natural gas in the system, I could imagine that we decouple this fossil fuel with natural gas and other fossil fuels and renewables, and you set the prices separately. It's one of the possibilities. If we, the more we go out of fossil fuels, the situation will be regulated by itself. So I think it is high time now to see how best can we make a transition. What I am not liking, quite honestly, is national, how you say that in English,
interference.
Yeah, that they go on their own and just looking for their territory and to do what they think is best to do, and without looking to a broader solution
that also works for other member states, because the problem is not only here in Spain, the problem you have also elsewhere.
Absolutely. See, I think here you pose, but we cannot resolve it here, the issue of market design. So there are concerns that we should improve the market design, in particular with a view to the transition. But I don't think there is a consensus on how to do it. I don't see a consensus, not even between countries or politicians, but even among the researchers. I don't see yet the consensus.
Xavier, let me add one point that is important. We would not talk about this for the Iberian Peninsula if the connectivity of the Iberian Peninsula would be different from what it is. As long as you cannot, in electricity, the French, they do not want that we go via the Pyrenees. In gas, I mentioned it, Midcat is still frozen. As long as you remain in an island mode, if you want, you will have problems that are different from the rest, because where you have large interconnectors, there you can have an exchange of energy, which would also help to keep prices in check. But unfortunately, I mean, I know that we are discussing that for decades, and nothing is happening. Nothing is happening. So really, the politicians should go back and to make this happen in power lines and also in gas terms.
Absolutely. I think there is there is agreement on the necessity of the interconnections not to stabilize the European market. But also, I would say, going back to that, to have a market design that does not need these ad hoc interventions, which at the end, they generate distortions. I mean, we know that when you cap prices without thinking about the consequences, distortions occur. And so then, in a sense, this is the problem, and still we do not have a good solution. So let me pose a final question because of time to both of you, which is the following. And it's related more because of short-run concerns on Russia and the sanctions that had been put in place against Russia, especially in the oil market, not only. The question is, how effective are they? The person that put the question points out very rightly, it seems that the Russian income, in fact, if you look at the balance of payments, has increased, is more positive rather than decreased. China and other countries are still buying and possibly redistributing Russian oil. What should be done? And here, if I may add, also there are proposals that have been floated by some academics that maybe instead of sanctions in the form of these kind of quotas or zero quotas, tariffs would be better, because they introduce some flexibility and they would damage more, in a sense, the Russian budget. So this is not immediately related to the energy transition, but definitely it's very, very important in the short run. Well, let's hope in the very short run, but I'm not so sure. So what's your view on that?
In generally speaking, we all know that sanctions are not always an instrument that really incentivizes the other party to change its behavior. And you can see that just with Russia. And what I see with the six sanction packages, which are all necessary, I'm not criticizing the sanction as such, but it is also clear that you will only see the effect in the longer term. And I think in some parts of the economy, Russia already suffers. It's not visible, or they are not acknowledging it, but it is there, and analysts have proven that. But having said that, because coming at to because you mentioned Gazprom is a good example, because a Russian analyst told me that she's not living in Russia anymore, but in the Oxford group in which I am also, she told us that Gazprom has completely changed its business model. Before, Gazprom's interest was to push volumes into the European market in order to strengthen its competitive situation and increasing its market power. And you were alluding to that, Xavier, in your introductory remark. Already before the last winter, when you looked at the big storages that Gazprom owns, they were empty or at very, very low level, and that was already a sign that they would change their business model. And their business model consists now just to make as much money out of it as possible. They are not interested in volumes. The volumes go down and their profits go up. So they deliver, they supply less gas, and they are earning more money. And the answer for me, it's exactly that, what you mentioned. I have not understood to introduce an import tariff of 30%. Where's the problem? It is a straightforward measure, and that hurts immediately. I can give you my explanation. I think that the politicians are afraid to take this decision because the retaliation measure could be that Gazprom or Russia stops delivering gas. And then we are in the immediate disruption scenario, which is difficult to cope with at this moment in time for some member states more than for others. And if I look to the country I knew best before I went to Brussels, Germany, they, if you have an immediate complete disruption of the gas deliveries, the next day Germany is in curtailment of its industries, with effects that you cannot yet foresee. So I think that's the reason why they are so reluctant. But if you look at the policy instrument, that would be, in my view, the most effective instrument to be chosen.
So that's very interesting. And in fact, what you say, the Russian gas disruption, I think it's already happened. So it's not happening 100%, but it's happening step by step in different countries. Now it says no, that to Germany that no, it has to be repaired a certain no, and then this will reduce the capacity 30%. I mean, obviously, all this looks very suspicious. No, that they have these accidents and repairs now, right? Okay, so I think that it's time to close. It's time to thank you very much, Naturgy, and Rafael in particular, the Naturgy Foundation, for supporting the Energy Prospective Series. This has been a success and continues to be a success. I recommend also the audience to read the publications of the Naturgy Foundation. They are very informative if you want to stay on top, no, of the developments in the energy sector. I've learned quite a few things in this session. I take from Klaus Dieter that the European plans, maybe they are too optimistic for the means that are being put there. They are not fully consistent, not fully realistic. There is quite a bit of political wishful thinking. So this means that we have a big challenge ahead. But maybe your contribution, I think, can serve as a guide to avoid mistakes. And then if we move on to California and the things that Hannon has told us, I think the main, well, first, the California record is impressive in the energy transition and control. So I think this should be taken as a model. But also, I think what's very important in my perspective is the emphasis on innovation, because really innovation is the only thing, I think, that they can relax the tension in the triangle between green, cheap, and safe. So without innovation, the trade-offs and the conflict will stay there. And I think really we have to put all effort to innovate. I saw this system of grants. I think that there is also quite good public-private partnership in this respect. And I think still in Europe, we should learn about how to develop better public-private partnerships. I would say in Spain, perhaps even more. Another important message, I think, from Hannon that I've learned is that the advancement of the problems with climate change make more difficult to fight climate change, not easier. So maybe it will be easier in terms of deriving a consensus on the population to attack this problem, but the problem is there. So with this, I think we should close. Thank you very much to the audience, to the virtual audience, and to the physical audience, and in particular to you both for such an insightful session. So thank you very much.
Our pleasure.